Otherwise, it will be a problem. Yes, I started it now. Okay. Now, this is lambda, right? Now, these are the three blueprints. Okay. So, three ways we can write in the code to in lambda. What is a blueprint? It is a configuration which combines sources and lambda functions. Okay. Yeah. Now, supposedly I'm setting this Python. So the source type here is S3, which is the recommended one. You can have a DynamoDB or CloudWatch logs as a source, or Kinesis, or simple notification services. Okay. Now, for bucket, we can have our own bucket if we have created an S3, or we can use the Elastic Beanstalk region bucket. So let's go with this. Event type is object created. This is optional, prefix and suffix. What is prefix? It's an optional prefix to limit the notification to object with keys. And suffix is, it limits the notification to object with keys which end with matching characters. If we don't specify it, like you can see prefix is images, okay? Suffix .jpg, .mp3, okay. So prefix is basically the starting, like images or audios, something like which identifies your files. And suffix is your extension of the files, .jpg, .mp3, .mp4, .3gpv. If you don't mention it, since these are optional, what happens is it adds necessary permissions to invoke our lambda function. Okay. So I don't have any file as of now. Okay. But now, see, this is my function name which I can give. This is the description. This is the runtime language. You can see there are three languages only, right? Python, Java 8, and Node.js.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this is a picture of the code entry type. So we have to provide the code. If the code does not require custom libraries other than this, we need custom libraries. So we can upload the codes or libraries in a zip file. Otherwise, we can edit the code line accordingly. The code has been written. This language basically is a Java language.
Okay.
Okay. Now, if I had a set of code, supposedly I've already built up a set of code which I wanted to run it, then I can always upload this in a zip file, provided it should not be larger than 10 MB. We can also upload it via S3. How can we upload it via S3? Do you remember?
Yes.
Through bucket. Yeah, through bucket.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if we happen to upload it via S3, upload a zip, we'll upload the zip by creating a bucket, and we'll give the URL of the bucket over here.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going with this entry type. I don't want to edit anything. So here we have mentioned df lambda handler, okay, which will be called from here, lambda function dot lambda handler. So handler will have, when the definition defined handler will be called, this particular set or this particular event would occur. Okay. The role, these are the roles. It says S3 execution role is the preferred one. Okay. No, so S3. So what is S3? We need to create a role for that. We create it through IAM. This is the execution role default. And I can create a role, a new role policy, or I can use a role without modification. So I'll create a new role. This is a view policy document. This is the script of the new role, of the logs and events which would happen. I'll give permission to this role. So once this is successful, this role has been created.
Okay.
Okay. Now, I have allotted 128 MB. I can allocate 512, whatever it is. Okay. It allows us to control the code execution performance.
Okay.
Okay. We can change the resource settings. We can also set up the timeout for that. Okay. Now. See, we can also assign VPC to it, okay, so that it can be access the database within the similar VPC, okay?
Yeah.
But since I don't have a code or something, if I want, I can use this VPC. I can use the subnet, which is there, which will automatically come. Security group will come. Inbound rules will come. Outbound rules will be defined. Okay. And I'll click next. Now, I can enable the event source now or later. So if I enable it now, if the event is created, and it will begin invoking a function. We recommend testing the function in the next screen before enabling. So that is recommended. Now we create a function. So yeah. I am not authorized to perform create a network interface. Okay.
Okay.
So I cannot create a VPC. This was I selected 512, right?
Yeah.
So I'll create not in VPC. There's one more thing. Don't create a VPC unless until you are very sure you're going to use it, because after some time it will be chargeable to you.
Okay.
Okay. So this is my event sources. I'll test it. Hello world. The common one is save and test. Below you can see some function execution. Can you see this? The down one, yep. So the area below shows the result returned by the function. The function was executed as per the code. There were errors. Okay, what was the errors? Key error record lambda function Python script, since it was, I used Python 2.22.28. So the script of Python was executed. Okay. Request ID, okay. There was some, 1 minute here, request ID report, request ID, key error bucket, even when a function was, shows that execution failed. Why did the execution fail? Let's see.
So, this lambda functions, basically, I mean, in which scenarios these are being used? So what I read a little bit of lambda is, that going ahead, it could be that you might.
The use cases is like if you want your application for application scenarios, wherein in order to provide computation to the applications. Like.
So when you say yeah.
Like. Maintaining the performance of the application, one use case, or monitoring it, one use case. Okay, then that is managing your computer resources. You can use a lambda function.
Okay, but say for example you say monitoring, but for monitoring you already have some CloudWatch over here.
Yeah, so I do have CloudWatch, but apart from CloudWatch, if I want to add something else, or I want to define some other parameters also, which my CloudWatch would not do it. Or if I want to do a scripting, or I have a script of Python for monitoring, and I want that script to work, then I'll use that lambda functionality to use it. As I can see, I showed you, there is a Python script, right? And there is an option to upload it.
Yeah.
So that's the one.
I'm just trying to understand or differentiate between can those things which have been written in Lambda can be done on the bootstrap or within the instances, or it has to be in the Lambda. So I'm just trying to find out the difference in those
okay.
cases.
The things which are being done in the Lambda can be done in within instances. That is true. But in case the instances, whatever code or what function you have written it and it's outside the instance, okay, and you want that code to work. See, cloud front watch, which is a metric, you define the metrics, it gives you CPU, memory, and your infrastructure. Now, in case of a, when would I use Lambda? Now, I have an application stored in or application built upon AWS, right? Any application you can say. Mm-hmm. If I want to monitor the processes of the application, means the components which are involved in the application to run the application, if I want to monitor those things, and I have a nice script already made in Python or Java, I don't want to use the matrix thing, then I can upload it using Lambda, get and use the same VPC on which the instances are and monitor it.
Okay.
There are two types. Yeah. Like monitoring are of 2 to 3 levels, right? One is your infrastructure monitoring, be it an application server or a database. Another is the monitoring of AWR reports in case of Oracle database, or in case of other database, the monitoring of which include gives you the capacity, which gives you the cost of the queries.
Yeah.
So there is, if we happen to see in Oracle, there is something called AWR RPT dot SQL, SQL. Those are the scripts, okay, right? So when we connect through SQL plus and execute @AWR RPT.SQL or by giving the path, it runs the AWR report, asks us the instance IDs, asks us the snapshot of the time period, and gives us the snapshot of the database performance during that period. So what does it give us? It gives us CPU usage, IO usage. It gives us page in, page out. It gives us which queries took how much time, what was the cost of the queries, corresponding SQL IDs, what were the long running IDs, long running SQLs, how much, for how long did it run, what, how many blocks were there, how many weights were there, right? Now, this is something which we get after executing in SQL Plus. Now, we have built up an Oracle database, we'll monitor it. We have set up a metric chart. So what it will monitor? It will monitor the OS usage, swap memory, memory, page in, page out, VNSTAT, to do all sort of things, okay? It'll do, but it would not explicitly go down to each and every query to figure out or give you the AWR report. Now you have an AWR report SQL. You call that SQL through a Python script. Now that Python script, you want it to function in AWS instance. So you can upload that AWS instance through Lambda on the same VPC on which your instances are. Why same VPC? So that your code can connect to that instance and give you the report.
Yes.
Were you able to record it now?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
So basically, if I sum it up, it is sort of an you can say it to be an ideal compute platform for application scenarios wherein we can monitor the resources of the application by the code written by us.